dear students. Wish you all stay happy, healthy and safe at home and do your studies regularly and properly. I'm Khushna Parak and today we are going to see a chapter for Standard 9 from your English textbook Moment, that is your supplementary reader. From that book, we are going to see chapter number 4, In the Kingdom of Fools. This is a Kannada folk tale from A.K. Ramanujan's Folk Tales from India. Now, this is the second part of this chapter. First part has already been taught to you. In first part, we saw that there is a kingdom which is ruled by foolish king and minister. And they made rules such as people will have to consider day as night and day night as day. So they will have to work in the night and will have to sleep in the morning. Even cattle were also taught to do the same. Otherwise, the king made the rule that the one who will disobey the rule made by the king will have to be punished by death. So because of the fear of death, they all obeyed the rules made by that foolish king and minister. Now once a guru and his disciple entered in that town and they were surprised to find such things. In the evening when the shops started, when everyone started their business, because they were tired since morning, they were wandering in the town and now they wanted some food. So when they went to get some food, they find that everything had the same cost, 1 rupee. So they got the food and after that when they were eating, the guru thought that this is not right whatever is happening here. And he felt that the king and minister are not clever and no one knows what will be their next step. And because of them, anyone can fail into problems. So he decided that he will not stay there. But his disciple did not agree with the guru because he wanted cheap and good food, which he was getting there. So that is why he didn't leave that place, but guru left. After that, an incident occurred that once a robber during day, he broke the wall of a merchant's house and entered in it, and when he was carrying the stolen things out from that house, the wall was weak and it collapsed on that robber, on that thief. And that thief died on the spot. Why he entered during day? Because during day everyone used to sleep. So after his death, his brother went to the court, to the king, and he asked the king for the justice. Now the king called that merchant and merchant said that that is not my fault, it is the fault of the bricklayer, the one who built this wall. Then bricklayer was called and he said, it is not my fault, it is the fault of the dancing girl who distracted me. Then dancing girl was called and she said, again it is not my fault, it is the fault of goldsmith who didn't give my jewelry on time, that is why I had to go up and down on that street. So that bricklayer got distracted. Now that goldsmith was called and he knew all the story and he blamed that merchant. And he said that I had to complete the jewelry given by that merchant first. And so that I could not complete the jewelry of this dancing girl on time. And that is why she had to go up and down. So the merchant is to be blamed because of whom I could not make her jewelry on time. So finally that merchant was the same person who was first count as culprit. So now the king became an angry and rudely he called that merchant. Now the merchant said that those ornaments were given by my father, and now he is not alive. I am his son, but I have not done anything. So I am innocent. Please don't punish me. But the king had to punish someone for the death of that thief, because his brother wanted justice. So now he decided that he will punish that merchant. Now we will see in this second part what happens to that merchant, how this case gets solved, and whether this foolishness come to an end or not, and how. So let us start the second part of this chapter. But the king consulted his minister and ruled decisively. It's true, your father is the true murderer, but he is dead. But somebody must be punished in his place. You have inherited everything from the criminal father of yours, his riches as well as his sins. I knew at once, even when I first set eyes on you, that you were at the root of this horrible crime. You must die. So now the king made the decision after consulting with minister. Even though that decision was not correct, it was partial. But still, as the king was foolish and all the people of that town had to follow the rule made by king, because unless they will be punished by death. So he made the decision and he said that it is true that the true murderer is your father. Because of your father, this thief has been died. But as he is not alive, so someone had to be punished. And as you have inherited, you have got everything from your father, his riches, his money, his wealth, and also his sin. The wrong deed of your father will be followed to you also. So he said that now you will have to be punished in the place of your father. He says that at once when I saw you for the first time, I knew that you are in the root of this crime, of this horrible crime. So now, as it has been proved, so there is no chance or there is no query about your punishment. So you will have to be punished by death. As he ordered a new stake to be made ready for the execution. As the servants sharpened the stake and got it ready for the final impaling of the criminal, it occurred to the minister that the rich merchant was somehow too thin to be properly executed on the stake. He appealed to the king's common sense. The king too worried about it. Stake that is opposed with a sharp, pointed and used to pierce through something. Execution, that means an official killing of someone. Impaling, that means to push a sharp, pointed post through something. Now, stake is suli. So, it is a sharp, pointed post on which the criminal has to be set, and it will pierce through that criminal. So, it will go through his body. Now, the stake was being sharpened, and as they were being ready for the execution, for killing that merchant, As the servant sharpened the stake and got it ready for the final impaling of the criminal, for it was being ready for the implementation of the decision taken by king. But now, when it was made properly, they got to know that somehow the merchant is too thin to be fit for that stake. And he ordered a new stake to be made ready for the execution. The king ordered that new stake is to be made for the execution for killing this merchant. As the servant sharpened the stake and got it ready for the final impaling of the criminal, now the criminal was about to be punished. It occurred to the minister that the rich merchant was somehow too thin to be properly executed on the stake. So he will not be fit on that stake because he is too thin. He appealed to the king's common sense. So he requested to the king that through your common sense, think that this merchant is not fit for the stake. Now someone is to be punished and stake is already made. So now, as today is the day of punishment and the stake cannot be repaired today only, now we have no option, we have to find someone for this stake, fit for this stake. The king also got worried about it, that what we will do, because merchant is thin and stake will not be fit for that merchant. And as the decision is made that someone has to be given punishment for the death of that thief today only, so we have to execute that punishment today anyhow. So they both were worried that how that execution will be done. "What shall we do?" he said, when suddenly it struck him that all they needed to do was to find a fat man enough to fit the stake. Now, what they thought, that the stake is not fit for the slim man. So what we have to do, we have to find a thick man, a fat man to fit on this stake. This is what all we have to do. They had nothing to do with the case. For justice, just one person should be hanged for the death. So they just have to find a person to be punished. That will be the justice for the thief's brother. So this kind of decision was made by the king without any logic. The servants are immediately sent all over the town looking for a man who would fit the stake. And their eyes fell on the beggar who had fattened himself for months on bananas and rice and beans and wheat and ghee. So as everything was cheap and he could get everything in just one room, so he ate a lot, and for several months he had eaten a lot, and now he had become too much fat. Now the servants were sent to find a fat man, and in the whole kingdom the servants could find only one person, that was the disciple who had gone fat because of eating so many things during these months. So they thought that this fat man, this disciple, could be fit for this stake, and they took that disciple to the court for hanging him on the stake. What have I done wrong? I'm innocent. I am a sannyasi, he cried. That may be true, but it is a royal decree that we should find a man fat enough to fit the stake. They say, those servants told him and carried him to the place of execution. Decree, that means order. So when they caught this disciple, he got afraid and he said that I am sannyasi and I am innocent. Why are you catching me? What wrong have I done? So they replied that it may be true that you haven't done anything wrong. But this is the order of king that we have to find a fit one. And that is why, as you are fit for the stake, that is why you are being taken to the place of execution. Now you will be hanged for death without any scene. So the servants had to follow the order given by the king blindly. And that fat decibel was taken to the place of execution. He remembered his wise guru's words. This is a city of fools. You don't know what they will do to you next. So, at that time, he got reminded of his guru's words. He got reminded that guru had already said that this is the kingdom of fools. They do not understand anything and they make decisions without any sense, without any logic, without any reason. So, you never can assume that what they will do next. Anything can happen because here, there are no rules, there are no sense, there is no sense, there is no logic. So, because of that, as the king and minister are fools, they cannot make proper decision, but still, everyone will have to follow it. So, it is not safe for us to live here. He already warned the disciple, but he didn't hear that time, and now he got remembered his guru's words that if I had obeyed my the words of my guru, so I would not have to face this problem. So now when he realized that this place is also this place is actually ruled by fools and no one can assume that what will be happen with him next. Anything can happen with anyone in that kingdom because they had no logic, they had no reason, they had no sense. And the king and minister both were fools. And this kingdom was ruled by fools. So no one can assume what will be their next step. So that is why the guru had already warned him, but as he wanted the cheap and good food, so in that greed he stayed there and he had to face the result of his greed. So now he got to remember the words of his wise guru and he feel regret for not obeying his guru. While he was waiting for death, he prayed to his guru in his heart, asking him to hear his cry wherever he was. The guru saw everything in a vision. He had magic powers. He could see far and he could see the future as he could see the present and the past. So the guru was very intelligent and he had the powers to see future, past and present. And he could see anything and he can go anywhere. Now, while he was waiting for his death, he prayed to his guru in his heart, asking him to hear his cry, to hear his request wherever he was. And the guru had the powers to see everything in vision. He could see in future, past and present. So Guru could hear the cry of his decibel. He arrived at once to save his decibel, who had got himself into such a scrape through love of food, just because of his greed. Scrape, that is a difficult situation that one has got into. So when Guru heard the cry of his decibel, when the decibel was praying in his heart to Guru, and the Guru had powers that he could hear and he could see all the things. So at the sudden time he arrived there, and he wanted to save his decibel from this difficult situation in which he had thrown himself because of his greed, because of his love of food. As soon as he arrived, he scolded the disciple and told him something in whisper. First he scolded because of not obeying his order, because of not obeying his wise words. And then to save him, he whispered something in his ears. Then he went to the king and addressed him, "O wisest of the kings, who is greater, the guru or the disciple?" "Of course the guru, no doubt about it. Why do you ask?" "Then put me to the stake first. Put my disciple to death after me." So the guru went to the king and he, addressing the king, he said that, "You are the wisest king of all the kings in the world. So only you can tell me that who is greater, guru or disciple." So the king was proud on himself and he replied that, "Obviously guru is wise, guru is great, but why are you asking?" So he replied that, "If you think that guru is great than greater than disciple, so I should be put to the stake first, and after me my disciple should be put to the stake." When the disciple heard this, he understood and began to clamor, "Me first, you brought me here first, put me to the death first, not him." Clamor, that means insisting. So when he heard the words of Guru, he got understand that what Guru is planning. So the disciple started insisting the king that, "Not to Guru, but put me on the stake first, because you have got me for the stake. So as I have arrived here first, so I should be put to the stake first." The guru and the disciple now got into a fight about who should go first. The king was puzzled by this behavior. "Why these people want to die?" He asked the guru, "Why do you want to die?" "We chose him because we needed a fat man for the stake." So when they started quarreling, the king got puzzled that whoever wished to die first. He had never heard so, he had never seen so. So he got puzzled, he got confused at why they are behaving like this. So he asked the guru that, "Why do you want to die? We brought your disciple here because we wanted a fat man for this stake. So we can understand why your disciple want to die. But why you want to die? Because we didn't call him here." "You should ask me such questions. You shouldn't ask me such questions. Put me to death first," replied the guru. "Why?" There is some mystery here. As a wise man, you must make me understand. Will you promise me to put me to death if I tell you? Asked the guru. So now, as the king got puzzled, could not understand that why they both were quarreling for death. That was very surprising for the king. So the king asked the guru that why do you want to die? The guru replied that you should not ask me such questions. Just put me on the stake. I want to die first, replied the guru. Then the king again asked, why? As you are the wise man, you are the guru. So only you can make me understand the reason why are you quarreling. And you will have to explain me this thing. So he put a condition, the guru put a condition that only if you will promise me that after telling you the truth, you will put me on the stake first. Then only I will tell you the reason. The king gave him his solemn words. The guru took him aside out of the servant's earshot and whispered to him, do you know why we want to die right now? The two of us, we have been all over the world, but we have never found a city like this or a king like you. That stake is the stake of the god of justice. It's new. It has never had a criminal on it. So now the guru explained him and he took him in the corner away from the eye, from the ears of his servants. So his servants won't be able to hear their conversation. And the king gave his promise that he will put guru on stake first. Because he wanted to know the reason why they were quarreling and why they want to die first. So the guru replied that, do you know why we both want to die first? Right now, we have been all over the world. We have wandered all over the world. But we have never found such a kingdom and such a king like you. That stake is the stake of God of justice. And yet, it is new and no criminal has been put on this stake. So this stake, as this is the God stake, the God of justice. So we want to die first because we want to go to the God of justice. What will be after dying? Whoever dies on it first will be reborn as the king of this country. And whoever goes next will be the future minister of this country. We are sick of our ascetic life. It would be nice to enjoy ourselves as king and minister for a while. Now keep your words, my lord, and put us to death. Me first, remember. Ascetic life is the life of a sannyasi, a strict life, life of discipline. So, the guru says that as we are sannyasi, we have to live the life of discipline. And this is the ascetic life we are living. But we also want to enjoy the luxurious life of king and minister. So that is why we want to go to the stake first, because the one who will go on the stake first will be the next king. In the next born, he will be the king of whole country. And the one who will go to that state second will be the minister of the whole country. So that is why I want to die first, so that I can be the king in my next born of this whole country, and my disciple will die second, so that he can be the minister of whole country in his second born or in his rebirth. So now you have to keep your words, you have to keep your promise, and you will have to keep me you will have to put me on the stake for death first. So in this way the guru gave the reason that I want to be the next king and my disciple would be the next minister of this country, that is why we want to die on that stake. The king was now thrown into deep thought. He didn't want to lose the kingdom to someone else in the next round of life, even not in when he will get rebirth. He needed time, so he ordered the execution postponed to the next day and talked in secret with his minister. Postpone, that means to put off something for a letter, for later time. That means it will be done after some time. So it was postponed for the next day. Now the king did not want to lose his throne even in the next birth. So he wanted to be the king forever. And when he heard the guru, the words of guru, he was thrown into deep thought that how can I lose my kingdom? How can I give it to anyone else? How can I forget my kingdom and give it to anyone else even in the next round of life, even in the next birth? So he needed some time to think that what he should do, and he consulted with his minister, and for once he postponed the implementation of that punishment, and he ordered that this execution will be done in the next. It is not right for us to give over the kingdom to others in the next life. Let's go on the stake ourselves and we will be reborn as king and minister again. Holy men do not lie or do not tell lies, he said, and the minister agreed. Now the king said that it is not good for us that to leave the kingdom for other people even in the next life. So we should go to the stake. I will go first so that I can be the next king, and you will go second so that you can be the next minister. The holy men do not tell lies. That means you can believe on the words of guru. So he said this to minister to make him agree, so that they will not have to lose their kingdom even in the next birth. So they believed the words of guru, and finally minister also agreed with the king, and they decided that they will go to stake and they will reborn as king and minister in the next birth. So he told the executioners, we will send the criminals tonight, not in the next day. When the first man comes to you, put him to death first, and then do the same to the second man. Those are my orders. Don't make any mistake. So the king called the executioners and he ordered them that the execution will be performed tonight only, and the one who will come to you first, you have to put the one first on that stake, and the one who will come to you second, you have to put him second on the stake. And do not make any mistake in my orders. You have to obey it just as I told you. That night, the king and his minister went secretly to the prison, released the guru and the disciple, disguised themselves as the two, and as arranged before hand with loyal servants, were taken to the stake and promptly executed. Disguise then is a different appearance in order to hide one's identity. Now the king and minister wanted to hide their identity, because if the king will go directly, so those executioners will feel fear that if we will hang the king may punish us. They cannot hang the king, as the king is the ruler of that kingdom. So they disguised themselves and they took the appearance of Guru and Nisipal in the night secretly, and they released Guru and Nisipal. And secretly they went into the prison, released Guru and Nisipal, and took the appearance of Guru and Nisipal, and secretly they went to the place of execution, and they were taken by their loyal servants, and finally, promptly, quickly, the execution was done. The decision taken by king was executed, and the one who came first, that means the king, was put on the stake first, and the one who came second, that is the minister, was put on the stake second, and promptly, quickly, it was executed, and they both died. When the bodies were taken out to be thrown to crows and vultures, the people panicked. They saw before them the dead bodies of the king and the minister. The city was in confusion. All night they mourned and discussed the future of the kingdom, because the night was day for them. So all the work was done in the night only. Some people suddenly thought of the Guru and the Nisipal and caught up with them as they were preparing to leave the town unnoticed. Because secretly the Guru and his disciple were released from the prison. So unnoticed, without being noticed, they were leaving the town. When in the morning the bodies were thrown out, after the execution of that decision, when the bodies were to be thrown out for the crows and vultures, then the people of that town saw that the bodies were of king and minister, and they got panicked, they got shocked, they got worried, because now as the minister and king were not there, who will rule the kingdom? They all were in confusion that how this happened, and whole night they mourned, they cried and discussed about the future of the kingdom, that how this kingdom will be ruled now after. Some people suddenly thought of the Guru and the disciple, because they were wise, and because of them only this idiot king and minister were put on the stake. So now we can get rid of this foolish rule, and we can get intelligent king and minister in the form of Guru and his disciple. So someone thought about them that we should find them, because of them our king and minister had died. And they caught them as they were preparing to leave the town unnoticed. They didn't want to come in notice of anyone, because they were released from the prison secretly. We people need a king and a minister, said someone. Others agreed. They begged the Guru and the disciple to be their king and their minister. It didn't take much argument to pursue the disciple, but it took longer to pursue the Guru, because they were sannyasi. But disciple was agreed to be the minister, as he was somewhat greedy. But Guru did not not agree. It was too difficult to make him agree to be the king of their kingdom. So now, as the people of that kingdom needed a king and a minister, so they requested, they begged to the guru and disciple to be their king and minister. And the disciple could agree easily, but it was difficult to make the guru agree for this. But somehow they convinced the guru and disciple both. They finally agreed to rule the kingdom of the foolish king and the silly minister on the condition that they could change all the old laws made by the foolish king and minister. As they are not alive right now, so it is not necessary to follow those rules which were made by that foolish king and minister. From then on, night would again be night and day would again be day, and you could get nothing for a to-do. It became like any other place. So finally we got a happy ending, that the kingdom got a wise king and a wise minister, and now the old rules made by that foolish king and minister were not be applied, and they have got the rid from that foolish king and minister. Now they have got a sensible, logical and intelligent king and minister, and the new law will be followed by them as made by the guru and disciple, the new king and minister of that kingdom, and the old laws will not be followed. The new law made by the king, made by the guru, was that now night would be night and day would be day, and the kingdom will be ruled as like any other kingdom. And now after, you will get nothing in just one to do. So these were the wrong decision made by the previous minister and king, which were now turned away, and new laws were made by the new king, the guru and his disciple. And now after, they will follow the rules of that guru and the disciple as the new king and new minister of them. And the place will be as like any other kingdom, and now they will not have to face the trouble because of the previous king and minister's foolish rules. So in this way, the kingdom got a happy rule in the form of new king and new minister as guru and his disciple, because they were wise. Here we come to an end of this chapter. So we learned from this chapter that we should be away from foolish people, because we can fall into trouble because of their foolishness. So this was a message given by this chapter. Be wise and stay away from foolish people. With this, we come to an end of this video. Now we will meet in the next video. Till then, take care of yourself and be safe at your home. Thanks for being with me. See you.